Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship with St. Mark's Presbyterian Church in Orillia for the first Sunday after Christmas. Know that wherever you are this day, you are most welcome. It is right and just to acknowledge the land on which we all live and work, no matter where we find ourselves this day. We worship today on various traditional lands throughout Canada. Lands that have significance for the Indigenous people who lived and continue to live upon them, and whose practices and spiritualities were tied to the land and continue to develop in relationship to the territory and its other inhabitants today. Here in Orillia, we live, work, and play on land that has been a site of human activity for thousands of years. It is the traditional territory of the Anishinaabeg, specifically Ojibwe and Chippewa people. This territory is covered by Lake Simcoe Treaty 16 and the J. Collins Land Purchase. Please remember that we are all treaty people. I'm joined here in the sanctuary of St. Mark's by Mary Jo Wilson, our wonderful organist and music director, Larry Windrem, our equally talented sound technician, and some members of our choir, Bob and Margaret Rimkay and Helen McHugh. I am so grateful to all of you for sharing your gifts with us. As well, thanks as always to Irene Malik for ensuring the service is distributed through our website and to those who helped to deliver the CDs over the Christmas season. I am grateful to all of you. I'm also grateful to everyone who was able to join us for our special Christmas services and to all who shared their gifts to help them come together as they did. And as we are still in the season of Christmas, remember the 12 days of Christmas that take us to Epiphany, I would like to offer to you a blessing for Christmas that was written by Joyce Rupp. Let the star of hope blaze through discouragement, doubt, and disgruntledness. Let the star of kindness radiate today through what you think, feel, and do. Let the star of remembrance glitter in thoughts of good people and good deeds. Let the star of laughter sparkle in your eyes and in your smile. Let the star of joy dance in the corners of your heart that have forgotten to sing. Let the star of patience permeate that which you find difficult and irritable. Let the star of love encompass your heart, a ray of welcome for everyone you meet. Let us take a moment to quiet our hearts and our minds as we prepare to worship God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise God in the heights. Praise God, all you angels. Praise God, all you heavenly host. Let us all praise the Lord. Please join in singing our introit for today, One Small Child, which is number 71 in our St. Mark's songbook.
One small child in a land of a thousand, one small dream of a Savior tonight, one small
I would invite you to join me in turning our hearts to God in prayer. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we praise you from the heights and from the depths, in the heavens, on earth, and from the seas, in the courts of power and from the sidewalks of our lives. Your splendor shines from a manger where the light of the world was born to pierce the darkness. In the fragility of flesh, you are revealed to us face to face. And so we gather with all people in every place who have glimpsed your salvation and your grace to rejoice in your love born for us. Together we worship and praise you as Creator, Son, and Spirit, source of light, glorious light, wisdom of the ages. Source of all hope, you invite us to live in the light and to discover the splendor of your glory. We confess that we often choose to remain in the darkness instead. We allow our fears and hurts to hold us hostage. Our expectations of life prevent us from seeing new and real possibilities. You offer to us unconditional love, but we expect others to earn our love. Forgive us. May the new life born in the manger awaken new life in us and allow hope to dawn in the year ahead. We ask this in the strong name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Friends in Christ, here is the good news of the gospel. Jesus Christ is our light and our salvation. In him we are made new. Let us give thanks to God and be at peace with ourselves and with each other. Amen. Our first hymn today is Angels from the Realms of Glory, which is number 146 in the Book of Praise. And we're going to sing verses 1, 4, and 5. Our story for today does continue with the season of Christmas. It was a gift from Marilyn Brooke a few years ago, and it's called "Twas with a Twist: The Continuing Journey with Saint Nicholas as He Celebrates His Favorite Gift." It is by Richard L. Blackburn and Rhonda D. Carnahan. 'Twas the night before Christmas when all through the house not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. The stockings were hung by the chimney with care in hopes that St. Nicholas soon would be there. The children were nestled all snug in their beds while visions of sugar plums danced in their heads. And Mama in her kerchief and I in my cap had just settled down for a long winter's nap. When out on the lawn there arose such a clatter, I sprang from the bed to see what was the matter. Away to the window I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters and threw up the sash. The moon on the breast of the new-fallen snow gave the luster of midday to objects below. When what to my wondering eyes should appear but a miniature sleigh and 8 tiny reindeer, with a little old driver so lively and quick, I knew in a moment it must be St. Nick. More rapid than eagles his coursers they came, and he whistled and shouted and called them by name. Now Dasher, now Dancer, now Prancer and Vixen, on Comet, on Cupid, on Donner and Blitzen, to the top of the porch, to the top of the wall, now dash away, dash away, dash away all. As dry leaves that before the wild hurricane fly, when they meet with an obstacle mount to the sky, so up to the housetop the coursers they flew with a sleigh full of toys, and St. Nicholas too. And then in a twinkling I heard on the roof the prancing and pawing of each little hoof. As I drew in my head and was turning around, down the chimney St. Nicholas came with a bound. He was dressed all in fur from his head to his foot, and his clothes were all tarnished with ashes and soot. A bundle of toys he had flung on his back, and he looked like a peddler just opening his pack. His eyes, how they twinkled, his dimples, how merry. His cheeks were like roses, his nose like a cherry. His droll little mouth was drawn up like a bow, and the beard on his chin was as white as the snow. The stump of a pipe he held tight in his teeth, and the smoke it encircled his head like a wreath. He had a broad face and a little round belly that shook when he laughed like a bowl full of jelly. He was chubby and plump, a right jolly old elf, and I laughed when I saw him in spite of myself. A wink of his eye and a twist of his head soon gave me to know I had nothing to dread. He spoke not a word, but went straight to his work and filled all the stockings, then turned with a jerk, and laying his finger aside of his nose and giving a nod, up the chimney he rose. He sprang to his sleigh, to his team gave a whistle, and away they all flew like the down of a thistle. But I heard him exclaim ere he drove out of sight, "Happy Christmas to all, and to all a good night." But then in a twist I was whisked far away. I was right there beside him, St. Nick, in his sleigh. We traveled a distance, I know not how far. We were guided, illumined, we were drawn by a star. Then touching down lightly at our destination, a sight I beheld that defied explanation. Creatures of all descriptions and colors, from reindeer to snowmen, from princes to paupers. But why were they gathering, and why at a stable? Now what's this? It looks like a choir of angels. What's going on here? Why such a grand display? St. Nick pointed and whispered, "He's there, in the hay." Approaching the manger, St. Nicholas gave pause to acknowledge why he had become Santa Claus. The greatest of gifts laid wrapped tight, as in paper, and there, kneeling down, he worshipped the Savior. Together in reverence knelt we there in the stall to honor the greatest gift and gift giver of all. The Father confirmed his profound proclamation, "Merry Christmas to all, every tongue, tribe, and nation." Our Our hand washing song is the refrain from Angels We Have Heard on High. I don't think you're going to have trouble remembering the words for the hand washing song this week. So we're going to sing that twice. Angels We Have Heard on High is number 147 in our hymn book. Before we turn to read scripture, let us ask God to help us to understand his word. Let us pray. Oh God, we thank you for your word, for the way it helps us to form our vision for our future. As we hear your word this day, may it sharpen our focus on what you seek for us to be and to do. Help us to listen to what your spirit is saying to the church. Amen. Our first scripture reading is from the Hebrew scriptures. Again, we hear from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 61, verses 1 to 10, and 62, verse 3. I surely rejoice in the Lord. My heart is joyful because of my God, because he has clothed me with clothes of victory, wrapped me in a robe of righteousness, like a bridegroom in a priestly crown, and like a bride adorned in jewelry. As the earth puts out its growth, and as a garden grows its seeds, so the Lord God will grow righteousness and praise before all the nations. For Zion's sake, I won't keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake, I won't sit still, until her righteousness shines out like a light, and her salvation blazes like a torch. Nations will see your righteousness, all kings your glory. You will be called by a new name, which the Lord's own mouth will determine. You will be a splendid garland in the Lord's hand, a royal turban in the palm of God's hand. This is the word of the Lord. Our gospel reading today comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 22 to 40. This is a continuation of where we left off reading on Christmas Eve, that story of that first Christmas, and I don't think it's quite as well known as that part of the story. So here now, Luke 2, verses 22 to 40. When the time came for their ritual cleansing in accordance with the law from Moses, they brought Jesus up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. It's written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male will be dedicated to the Lord. They offered a sacrifice in keeping with what's stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. A man named Simeon was in Jerusalem. He was righteous and devout. He eagerly anticipated the restoration of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. The Holy Spirit revealed to him that he wouldn't die before he had seen the Lord's Christ. Led by the Spirit, he went into the temple area. Meanwhile, Jesus' parents brought the child to the temple so that they could do what was customary under the law. Simeon took Jesus in his arms and praised God. He said, "Now, Master, let your servant go in peace according to your word, because my eyes have seen your salvation. You prepared this salvation in the presence of all peoples. It's a light for revelation to the Gentiles and a glory for your people, Israel." His father and mother were amazed by what was said about him. Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "This boy is assigned to be the cause of the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that generates opposition, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your innermost being too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, who belonged to the tribe of Asher. She was very old. After she married, she lived with her husband for 7 years. She was now an 84-year-old widow. She never left the temple area, but worshipped God with fasting and prayer night and day. She approached at that very moment and began to praise God and to speak about Jesus to everyone who was looking forward to the redemption of Jerusalem. When Mary and Joseph had completed everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to their hometown, Nazareth, in Galilee. The child grew up and became strong. He was filled with wisdom, and God's favor was on him. This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. In the name of God the Father, our Creator, God the Son, our Redeemer, and God the Spirit, our Sustainer. Amen. Well, we did it. We can all breathe now. We made it through Christmas, a Christmas unlike I've experienced in my lifetime. Things were so new and everything was different and unfamiliar. It was at times really hard to not want to be surrounded by the traditions and trappings that I've come to love and associate with Christmas, to not be with all those I love so much. But nevertheless, on Christmas Eve, we celebrated what that great preacher Will Willimon calls the great interruption, the coming of God in person into our lives. And now, well, now we're faced with the great resumption, carrying on with our lives, business as usual, almost as if God had not come for each of us. Some of you may be feeling the same way I am. And I expect that following the very first Christmas, Mary and Joseph may have shared some of those feelings. After all, they had been through an entirely new experience, far away from their familiar traditions and surroundings, apart from those they loved the most. And experiencing parenthood for the very first time, well, that can be discombobulating for anyone. Talk about a great interruption in their lives. And now we read that they're resuming their normal lives, lives of faithfulness in both civil and religious duties. And so they've gone to Jerusalem, to the temple, to dedicate their baby boy as the rules of their religion would have demanded. Having been a new parent on more than one occasion, I remember how tiring it can be with a baby who doesn't sleep through the night or more than even a few hours at a time. And yet, they set off on another arduous journey to the temple in faithfulness to their religious tradition. And there they run into two people who know something about faithfulness, Simeon and Anna. They also know something about waiting. These two have been waiting their whole lives to see the promised Messiah. Simeon has been promised by the Holy Spirit that before he dies, he will see the Messiah. And Anna, who is named as a prophet, has lived most of her adult life in the temple, never leaving. fasting, and praying. And now she's 84 years old, and she's also waiting to see the Messiah. These two are closer to the end of their lives than the beginning, but they're about to see the beginning of this new thing that God is doing. Simeon and Anna have believed God's promises for a very long time. That unswerving belief is what they have built their lives on. They have been on the lookout for God for years, with only their open hearts and eyes and ears to guide them. They didn't receive an angelic visit. There was no star overhead for them to follow. They have just waited a long time for God's saving grace to show up, and God doesn't disappoint them. They are the first to recognize Jesus as the Messiah without help from the angels. There in the temple, as Mary and Joseph offer two tiny turtle doves as an offering to God, as thanks to God for this tiny baby, Simeon and Anna recognize Jesus as the one who will bring redemption and hope for all people. And what a beautiful response from Simeon. I imagine tears falling down Simeon's craggy cheeks, pooling in his long beard, as his hopes are realized and he cradles the sacred child at last in his arms. With joy wrapped in overwhelming emotion, he blurts out his blessing and he gives thanks that now he can depart at last in peace. Now, Master, let your servant go in peace according to your word, because my eyes have seen your salvation. You prepared this salvation in the presence of all peoples. It's a light for revelation to the Gentiles and a glory for your people Israel. And Anna, similarly moved, her face moistened with the emotion of sudden, unexpectedly fulfilled hope, blesses the boy and raises thanks to God on high. And she tells everyone who will listen to her about Jesus. These two aged people, who many would overlook as they visited the temple, they recognize the hope this child will bring to our world. Hope not just for kings and the powerful, but for carpenters and fishers, and old people and confused parents, and the working poor, and for those barely hanging on. For those caught in the changes of this life, Emmanuel, God with us, hope-bearing child, the Messiah, has come, wrapped in the body of a wee baby. And you know what? God still intervenes in the common and the ordinary and the small. God still shows up, is still at work in people we so often don't notice or overlook. Maybe what we all need in our lives are people to point out to us the closeness of God, especially when we can't see it for ourselves. When our eyes are misted over with worry or grief, when they have lost their ability to see because they are blinded by our own sense of our own importance and need to control our own lives. More than ever today, we need our own Anna and Simeons to keep watch for God in our midst. We need those who can see for us when things get difficult, those who help us to see Jesus when we are short-sighted. Perhaps we need to be Annas and Simeons for others, keeping watch for the holy, waiting and watching, and telling others of the presence of Emmanuel, God with us. I heard a story this week of one such person of faith who lived much as Anna and Simeon did. They said, "I've seen God so many times today, I know God's middle name." Isn't that a wonderful thing to be able to say? "I've seen God so many times today, I know God's middle name." You know what? Over this mixed up year, I too have seen God at work so often. And I want to share with you now a few of my sightings. I saw God when the hungry were fed, through sharing of food left on a doorstep at a safe distance, through trips to the grocery store when others couldn't go themselves, through donations to the food bank or Feed My Sheep or Presbyterian World Service and Development. I saw God when the grieving were comforted by socially distanced visits or phone calls or cards or emails, when a listening ear was offered over and over and over again. I saw God when the young among us were encouraged, and when they encouraged us by responding to God's promises by hanging the colors of the rainbow in the trees outside their homes, by remembering the sacrifice of others by painting beautiful poppies on rocks, by continuing to sing and play the songs of Christmas, even though we couldn't be together for a pageant this year. I heard God when they told us how much they missed coming to church. I saw God when I witnessed so many of you reaching out, not just to those who are part of our church family, but to those who may never have darkened the door of our church, reminding them that they are loved, being the hands and feet of God in this world. I saw God in the support of our online services, which give us the ability to reach out to so many we couldn't have connected with before. In the midst of the difficulties of this pandemic, you've encouraged us to look for new ways to spread the news that God is indeed with us. God is with us in the care you have offered, in the unexpected help and hope given. God is with us, Emmanuel. Because after all, we are the body of Christ here in this world. So where have you seen God lately? God is as close to you as breath. Don't miss seeing it. I believe that God is calling each one of us to be people who point to God, like Simeon and Anna, for people like Mary and Joseph who are weary and uncertain. And when we see glimpses of God's kingdom among us, don't be afraid to speak about it to all who will listen. After their visit to the temple that day, Mary and Joseph returned to their home in Nazareth, back to the ordinary, which is where most of us live our lives. And they saw the Messiah every day. Simeon and Anna are still in the world, waiting to see the body of Christ before their time is up. And maybe we can be the ones who show it to them. We would be wise to pay attention to the ordinary and the mundane in our lives, so we can continue to see how we can carry out God's work and give witness to it, to point to God with us, Emmanuel. Together, let's be on the lookout for God. Amen. Our hymn is, Do You Hear What I Hear? And I'm going to tell you the story about how it was written. And I think you will not sing it the same way when you know this story. This carol was written in 1962 by Noel Regney and Gloria Shane at the height of the Cuban Missile Crisis. Inspired by seeing babies pushed in strollers in New York City while the dire threat of nuclear war loomed, Noel wrote, Said the night wind to the little lamb, and pray for peace, people everywhere. The star dancing in the night with a tail as big as a kite can be interpreted as the Star of Bethlehem, but also what a nuclear missile looks like in flight. The composer said in an interview later that it was difficult to actually sing the song that year without crying. Indeed, our prayers for peace continue, and the need to protect the children of the world and secure a future for them are as dire as ever. So let us sing this carol, a song high above the trees, with our voices big as the sea. Please join in singing, "Do You Hear What I Hear?" I would invite you to adopt whatever posture is most comfortable for you for prayer and join me as we pray for our world. God of love, as we celebrate the birth and life of Jesus, our Savior, we are filled with thanks. Our gratitude overflows in prayers for our world, the world you love so much. We pray for all children. Guard their minds, protect their bodies, strengthen their characters, and give them joy. Help them look to the future with hope and trust. We pray for the most aged among us, those whom Simeon and Anna bring to mind. Protect them in the midst of the ongoing pandemic, and reassure them of their value to you and to us, even when we cannot meet together. We pray for those whose hearts are filled with pain and fear. We pray for those for whom Christmas is linked with loss or grief. We name them before you now in silence. Surround each one with a strong sense of your comforting presence. We pray for those who do not have enough to eat, and for those who lack adequate shelter in our community and in the most desperate corners of our world. For those who eat alone without the comfort of human contact, and for those whose hearts and lives have been broken by trauma and loss, and for those who struggle with the many costs of the pandemic. Surround each one with a strong sense of your comforting presence. We pray for family members and friends, those nearby and those we could not meet with this year. Remind them of our steadfast love. And to any who are struggling this season, O God, give your gift of peace. As the year draws to a close, we surrender to you, O God, the challenges it has held for us, so that they will not remain as burdens. Remind us of the good things that have offered us encouragement in times of isolation. We give you thanks for the people who continue to care for us and care about us. Give us courage and wisdom for the year ahead. We pray that our leaders will have wisdom and generosity of spirit for the decisions they must make on our behalf. We ask that you would guide scientists working to produce vaccines against COVID-19 and support all those essential workers whose faithfulness to their responsibilities helps us all cope in these difficult days. Grant us all the hope, joy, and peace we find through trusting you. And grant us eyes to see you in action in this world you love so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, as we come to the end of another year, I want to thank you so much for the many ways you continue to support the ministry here at St. Mark's. If you haven't had a chance to do so, you can make a financial donation to the church through our website. There are several options outlined there. And please keep praying for all of us as we continue to live in the reality of a pandemic. Your prayers really do make a difference, and we are grateful. Our final hymn is Lord, Dismiss Us With Your Blessing. And it is a new tune for some of us, so Mary Jo is going to play that, and then we will join in singing that together. Life is short, and there is not much time to gladden the hearts of those who walk the way with us. So make haste to love, be swift to be kind, And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and those you love this day and forevermore. Amen.
Breathe.